Hello friends, in the ongoing series on cultural matrix, I am going to reflect on the experience of being Indian. The questions that I would like to ask, is it possible for us as Indians to experience a thread of connectedness? What is the notion of unity or the experience of unity we are striving for? Or is it that are we destined to live only with differences, with no thread of connectedness and no notion of unity? I believe these questions are not merely academic abstract questions. These questions have acquired a new meaning, particularly in the times we live in. We are seeing, on the one hand, self-proclaimed nationalists. They are propagating and they are claiming that they have a unifying notion of nationalism, and anybody who has certain ambiguity towards it or critiques it is being castigated as anti-national. So in an environment of this kind, the questions are often being asked, what does it mean to be Indian, or what is Indian nationalism, or is there something called India, and what sort of unity are we striving for? We are also passing through a time when we are seeing diverse pockets of resistance against some of the policies that the ruling regime has undertaken. And because of this culture of resistance and discontent, this debate has acquired yet new meaning, because quite often the dissenters are being castigated as anti-national. So friends, the point that I'm going to reflect on, it's not abstract. It is something that bothers all of us, our everyday politics, the way we look at ourselves, and the way we engage with our society, with our nation and culture. It is in this context, there are primarily three issues that I would concentrate on. The first, I would speak of the quest, the ideal, the search. And that quest, the ideal, that search, which has been going on since ages, and I would characterize it as quest for some notion of rhythmic unity. India as an experience of rhythmic unity. And by rhythmic unity, I mean, it's like a music, it's like a song, you know, that has to be cultivated every second, every minute. Precisely because India is remarkably known for its heightened heterogeneity and differences in terms of culture, language, religion, geographical landscape, ethnicity. Despite that differences, what is that quest, what is that search we are striving for about certain kind of experience of India as a thread of connectedness, as a rhythmic unity? And I think this ideal, or this quest, or this song has three components. The first component is the acknowledgement of heterogeneity and differences. And it is important to acknowledge that there are innumerable differences and heterogeneity. And the differences and heterogeneity are not necessarily constraining. Differences and heterogeneity enrich us, enrich life. And heterogeneity and differences are very natural, part of the natural ecosystem. So acknowledgement and acceptance of this heterogeneity. The second component of that quest is that, together with that acknowledgement, there is the need for the empathy. And by empathy, I mean willingness to understand others, willingness to understand, imagine oneself in the position of the other, and to engage in an act of communication, to embrace the other and thereby overcoming the otherness of the other. So the empathy is another quest. So I may be a Hindu, but it is important for me to sharpen that quality of empathy that enables me, for instance, to understand a Sikh or a Christian or a Muslim. I may be a Bengali, but it should also enable me to understand how, for example, someone from Karnataka behaves. his or her food practices, rituals, beliefs. And this empathy leads to the expansion of horizons. We overcome the closeness of the mind, we open the windows of the mind, and we begin to learn one another much more meaningfully, and with empathy, certain kind of communication begins to exist. A bridge is being built and the barriers are overcome. And the third component of this quest is that despite the differences and heterogeneity, our shared humanity. And the moment we realize our shared humanity, despite being Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, Christian, you know, and that shared humanity leads to that understanding of that shared humanity leads to a quest for egalitarian justice. Basic necessities of life, food, clothing, shelter, dignified work, living conditions, education, this ought to be the shared destiny. In other words, the fighting the gross inequality, material inequality, economic inequality, and moving towards certain notion of egalitarian justice. I believe that this quest, this ideal for the rhythmic unity, characterized by these three components, acknowledgement of differences, accepting differences as natural, and then the empathy and simultaneous expansion of horizons and willingness to learn others, and third, the quest for egalitarian justice. That leads to unity as a rhythmic bridge, unity as a song, as a poetry, unity as a politics of love. But the tragedy is that, and herein lies my second point, the quest, that search, it is something that has to be perpetually kept alive through our living practices, through our education, through constant work on ourselves, on religion, on culture, on politics. It's an exceedingly difficult task, and we tend to move toward shortcut. And when we move toward shortcut, what emerges, and herein lies my second point, what emerges is a toxic notion of unity. And the toxic notion of unity is different from the rhythmic unity. Toxic unity confuses unity with homogeneity and uniformity. But believe it, uniformity and homogeneity leads to dullness. It kills differences. It is uncomfortable with ambiguity. It annihilates differences. And this quest for the homogeneity and uniformity and confusing unity with homogeneity and uniformity leads to certain kind of militaristic, monolithic, homogenized nationalism based on certain kind of majoritarian religious identity. Something of that kind we are witnessing today, what generally is known as majoritarian Hindutva as the dominant discourse of nationalism today. It is militaristic. It is based on the notion of uniformity and homogeneity. So militarism, homogenization, and the oppressive uniformity, that become characteristics of this toxic unity. And that toxic unity is qualitatively different from the quest for the rhythmic unity. And here lies my third point. The rhythmic unity was a quest, and there were many great Indian minds, the freedom fighters, great social reformers, great poets, political philosophers, Gandhi, Tagore, Swami Vivekananda, Guru Nanak, Kabir, and in our times, lot of people fighting for social justice, equity, they were striving for that notion of rhythmic unity. And that notion today is being replaced by the toxic, oppressive, militaristic, homogenized, monolithic nationalism, which is based on fear, which seeks to annihilate or the kill differences. And that is where lot of problems are emerging in India today, and wherein lies my third point. And it is in that context we could see the different languages of protest, diverse modes of protest. And protests are coming in India today from Shaheen Bagh to protest against Citizen Amendment Act, protest against Hindutva, these protests are coming. Although the ruling regime seeks to negate this protest as anti-national, and we are also seeing the mindless use of sedition charges against many dissenters. But the point is that this protest is emerging, and in that protest, possibly there is also a quest for that rhythmic unity. And at Shaheenbagh, at times, one experiences that quest for that lost ideal. Only point that I would remind myself and remind all of us is that let us fight another tendency which might happen in the name of protest. We might begin to entertain nihilistic fragmentation, and the idea of fighting against oppressive, toxic, militaristic nationalism is not to entertain the notion of fragmentation, notion of division, or the notion of communalism, or the limitedness based on narrow limiting identity of caste, language, and religion. The real art of resistance would emerge when that original quest for a rhythmic unity we would strive for, and our every act of resistance would fight not only the militaristic nationalism, but also it would create the new song of rhythmic unity that is based on heterogeneity, that is based on empathy, and that is based on justice. Is it the new language of resistance that today, at this crucial juncture of Indian history, you and I are striving for?